Tonight, the opposition takes the government to task for breaking an election promise to halve the driver's license fees. A Toronto-based hospital introduces local health practitioners to a faster, more accurate test for sickle cell disease. A call for a progress report on the John Compton Dam dredging project and an accounting for the funds collected to undertake it. And the minister with responsibility for tourism calls for urgent action on crime as concerns about its potential impact on the tourism sector grows. A very good evening to you. Welcome to the Thursday edition of the DBS News World. With me, Timothy Poulner. Our top story. The opposition St. Lucia Labour Party is again accusing the ruling United Workers Party of breaking election campaign promises by not delivering on the promised 50% reduction in license fees. Earlier, the SLP accused the party of backtracking on its promise to rid the diplomatic corps of political appointments when party chairman Guy Mayers was named as St. Lucia's High Commissioner to the UK. Now the SLP says it has failed to deliver the promised 50% cut in driver's license fees, delivering instead a 50% cut of a previous increase and not the entire fee. DBS's Don Nicholas begins our news coverage.
Leader of the opposition, Philip J. Pierre, produced a copy of the UWP manifesto which stated that the government would reduce the license fees by 50% and not 50% of the increase. Mr. Pierre went on to speak about taxation. He says the only way that government can reduce on VAT is to cut down on tourism tax incentives or increase the number of VATable items, most of which are purchased by the average citizen. Mr. Pierre is predicting that these changes will come sooner or later.
The question is, we have to look at revenue streams, and I'm making a prediction this morning. The government has two choices. The government either has to reintroduce consumption tax or they have to reduce incentives to the tourism industry and to industry. They have to. Or tax tourism through imposing a travel tax. I'm making that prediction, and the government must do it.
Then the leader of the opposition addressed the issue involving the Attorney General, who also functioned under the previous administration. Pierre says the attack on the Attorney General by the current administration is not justified.
Have you, members of the press, ever heard the AG or seen her in any political situation? I don't think the AG has ever worn a red or a yellow shirt. The AG is a professional. The Constitution only speaks to two ministers, the Minister of Finance and the AG. Now, second, the Attorney General is the government's legal advisor. The Attorney General is not a judge. The Attorney General doesn't convict people or say what cases are right or wrong.
Mr. Pierre says the Attorney General can be exempted from cabinet when political issues are being discussed. For the DBS News World, I am Don Nicholas.
In other news, representatives from the Hospital for Sick Children or Sick Kids in Toronto, Canada, are working with the Ministry of Health and the St. Lucia Sickle Cell Association to train local medical practitioners in the care of children with blood disorders and cancers. The team is also hoping to get local buy-in for a new method of diagnosing sickle cell and other conditions.
Sick Kids is a major pediatric hospital in Toronto that has sourced funding to allow it to work with health practitioners in six English-speaking Caribbean countries in order to improve the diagnosis and treatment of cancers and blood disorders in children. This week, the Sick Kids team was here in St. Lucia building on the island's success in the fight against sickle cell disease. So far, St. Lucia has led the rest of the region in diagnosing the condition in newborns, but the method used has not been the most accurate.
The cord blood or the blood from the umbilicus is a mixture of mother and baby. So it's not a pure testing of the baby, and it's been fraught with complications of misdiagnosis, false positives, or underlooked sickle cell disease that looks like the trait. So we have a new method of testing the baby itself at birth.
The establishment of a testing facility in Jamaica will allow for the condition to be diagnosed and the results returned electronically all within 48 hours. The use of blood drawn directly from the baby will significantly improve the accuracy of the diagnosis, but more than that, it can be used to diagnose up to 28 conditions.
This is futuristic because not only will one be able to test for sickle cell, if in the future policymakers in St. Lucia decide that there are other disorders to test, for example, in Ontario, Toronto, where I come, we test babies for about 28 different disorders. So using the same amount of blood, you can test for 28 different diseases.
With sickle cell still the most common condition threatening local children, this could be a major game changer and has been welcomed by the Sickle Cell Association. The challenge now is selling the idea to health practitioners and parents.
We are indeed very happy to be one of the islands chosen to start this procedure. What we have to do is to increase the educational process also for the parents and the mothers, and to know exactly what has to be done with the heel prick. And babies, even if they get a heel prick and they might cry, it really doesn't hurt, it stops very quickly. But the importance of the heel prick is to get that blood.
Sick Kids is also hoping to create a database of children with the condition in order to quantify the extent of the problem and to measure the impacts of any implemented interventions, something the St. Lucia Sickle Cell Association has also welcomed. For the DBS News World, Kendall Burton reporting.
And now this story. In November this year, both Mexico and Brazil will host major events aimed at establishing and strengthening business links with the Caribbean. A Brazilian mission being coordinated by a private Brazilian entity, Nomad Development, is due in St. Lucia from November 11th to the 17th. It will bring 15 investors and parliamentarians to the island to discuss a wide range of business opportunities. The Brazilians are interested in projects ranging from tourism and construction to alternative energy and agriculture. But while the Brazilians are heading to the Caribbean, the Mexicans have arranged the opposite, to invite Caribbean investors to talk and do business in Cancun. The Embassy of Mexico to the Eastern Caribbean States, based in St. Lucia, has announced that the 2016 Cancun Forum, Creating Synergies to Strengthen the Competitiveness of the Greater Caribbean, will be held November 16th to the 18th at the Peninsula Convention Center in Cancun, Mexico. According to the Mexican Embassy, the central aim of the Cancun Forum is to give Mexican exporters and buyers from the greater Caribbean countries the opportunity to make contact and start business relationships. A former chairman of the National Water and Sewerage Commission wants the government and WASCO to update the public on the status of the John Compton Dam dredging project and is calling for an accounting for the funds raised to undertake the initiative. Don Nicholas has more.
Recently, the Water and Sewerage Commission implemented a 66% increase in water rates. 10% of that increase was allocated to a project that would facilitate the dredging of the John Compton Dam. Former chairman of the commission, Truscott Augustine, says that monies are being collected for the project, but according to him, he is yet to hear anything on the progress made.
The levy, 10% was supposed to hold until sometime, I can't recall exactly the month, but during the latter part of last year. And then we came to the public and indicated to them, that is when I was chairman of the National Water and Sewerage Commission, that we would like to extend the levy that contributes, that constitutes the local contribution to the whole project of repairing the dam.
According to Mr. Augustine, the National Water and Sewerage Commission has been replaced by a National Utilities Regulatory Commission, but still no word on the status of the project.
I would think, my brother, I wouldn't prefer to say what is the state of the dredging fee, because I, like you out there, the general public, nobody has said anything. I don't know anything about that. I think Mr. Jerome Jules, who is the executive director of NUC, and the board, which is chaired by Mr. Victor Poyot, I think you should get in touch with these people and let them tell you what is really going on. And they are headquartered. Their offices are the same place where National Water and Sewage Commission was in Kiblan Wireless Yard.
The relevant authorities could not be reached for comment. For the DBS News World, I am Don Nicholas.
Time now for Street Vibes.
Hi, I'm Alex Buske, and you're watching Street Vibes. Making gun licenses easier for business people, bus drivers, ordinary citizens to have, will that worsen or lessen on gun crimes?
I don't think so. I think it will make it worse. Because I noticed that bus drivers always asking for guns. I could understand if what's happening to them, eh? And also the taxi drivers. But at the end of the day, there are some ignorant drivers sometimes. I mean, sometimes they have to go behind the police cut. Plus, I see them do that already when they owe them their money or they sometimes people run away from the van. So I don't think that's a good idea. I think it only makes things worse.
I don't think really it would curb gun crime, you know. I figure it would increase gun crime because you have a lot of determined young guys out there who'd really go out to see that they hold up most of these citizens they think that have guns, you know, and you know, just to increase probably their what? Their battalion or increase their armory, you understand me?
So
by taking the firearm, you know, holding up the people and taking the firearms. So I don't think it would really, you know, curb any gun crime in St. Lucia. It would really increase it because more citizens would have firearms and, you know, the deterrent factors would go out there to see that they take these ammunitions from these residents.
Issuing guns to citizens will only bring more gun violence because people have to be well trained to use guns and all this kind of thing. So, I mean, we just basically will put St. Lucia in a bloodbath if we do this kind of thing. So, I'm not in support of that at all. What I am in support with is social justice, creating an atmosphere in St. Lucia where there will be no need for guns, where people have to go and look for guns for their security and so on and so forth, because a lot of these gun-related problems, people let's say it's gangs and so on, St. Lucia don't have no gangs like other countries. There's nothing about gangs in St. Lucia. It's a matter of youth, troubled youth, and they feel, well, okay, they in war with that side or they in war with that side and they want to take up guns and kill each other. So it's a matter of intervening. We need people where we could put social programs in place and reputable people that could go into these areas and talk to the youth and try to see if we could bring about a bit of peace among the youth. Have some kind of, I wouldn't say a peace treaty, but have a kind of situation whereby we could counsel those youth. Because some of the youth don't want to get involved in this kind of violence, you know, and they were looking for people to intervene to even probably help them save their own lives.
So intervention is the key.
Not no putting guns in more people's hands, in citizens' hands. No, I don't think so at all. Social justice, equal rights and justice for one and all, and intervention. Intervention is the main thing. To go into those areas, responsible, serious people, go into those areas and speak to those youth.
Them fellas nowadays, they like to just umbre people, just doing people wickedness, people working so hard for their money and you just want to rob people. It's just, I feel the government. Not everybody should give a license, but certain business people and certain drivers, because them fellas just overdo it, you know?
Well, there you have it. You've just been watching Street Vibes with me, Alex Buske, down here at the Aquarius Crossing, the intersection of Coral and St. Louis Street. With that, we'll take you back to our studio.
Thank you very much, Alex. You are watching St. Lucia's television and news leader and listening to us on Rhythm FM 95.5. We are also online on the big screen at the Aquarius Crossing in downtown Castries. Still to come, the tourism minister raises concerns about the likely impact of unchecked criminal activity on the tourism industry. And the education minister appeals for more special ed teachers. Thank you so much for staying with the DBS News World. The island's minister with responsibility for tourism says crime and its potential impact on the tourism sector remains a very serious concern. That concern goes well beyond issues of visitor harassment and attacks on visitors to the loss of investor confidence as well. Dominic Fede says the industry's economic centrality demands an urgent and holistic approach to tackling the issue. Don Nicholas has more.
Tourism Minister Dominic Fede was speaking in light of the perceived escalation of crime in the city and the effect that it could have on visitors and, by extension, the tourism industry. In view of this, the minister is calling for a holistic approach to combating crime.
I'm never one to assume without doing proper research, and I haven't got any information before me to suggest that there has been a significant impact on our visitor experience. But I want to say to you that the Tourist Board and the Ministry of Tourism, we continue to embrace our private sector partners. We continue to talk and we continue to dialogue each other to see how best we can deal with not just that particular challenge that you have mentioned, but other challenges that are facing the industry as well.
Minister Fede would also like to see the police speak with more specificity about crime on the island, and he intends to work with the National Security Minister in this regard.
Our product St. Lucia remains very, very strong, and we're still one of the safest places in the world to visit. And, you know, personally, as a citizen, as a resident of St. Lucia, I feel extremely safe. And yes, like every other place in the world, there are places that you shouldn't go. And of course, I would like the police department and the Home Affairs Ministry to speak with more specificity and more wisdom, and speaking in a more informed way on the situation as it relates to crime on the island.
Mr. Fede is in the process of working with the National Security Ministry in organizing a symposium which will facilitate the sharing of ideas on the way forward. For the DBS News World, I am Don Nicholas.
The island's minister with responsibility for tourism has made an appeal to the American Peace Corps for special education teachers. These teachers would work with students who have learning, mental, emotional, or physical disabilities. Skills, the minister says, the island is in dire need of. She made the comments at the ceremony to welcome 7 new volunteers.
7 Peace Corps volunteers will, for the next 24 months, commit themselves to working with children in the area of reading and literacy in St. Lucia. Minister for Education, Innovation, Gender Relations and Sustainable Development, the Honorable Dr. Gil Rigobert, welcomed the volunteers at a recent introduction ceremony. Dr. Rigobert believes the volunteers are bringing a wealth of knowledge and experience, which she says is beneficial to all St. Lucians.
We recognize, too, that your presence here means that you are mindful of our resource gaps and that you have made tremendous sacrifices to lend of yourselves and your talent to our beautiful little island, which I'm very happy to note that you are already referring to as home.
The minister also called on Peace Corps St. Lucia to give special consideration to recruiting volunteers in the area of special education.
I ask, therefore, that in your interview and selection process in the years to come, if you would perchance just consider attracting persons with that particular skill set so we can integrate them into our special education program. Because we recognize that is a dire need, and indeed no child shall be left behind in this island of St. Lucia, especially those with special needs.
In addition, the minister thanked the Peace Corps for embracing St. Lucia's linguistic diversity. From the communications unit of the Ministry of Education, Innovation, Gender Relations and Sustainable Development, I am Fidel Neptune reporting.
In other news, a 12% decline in arrivals from the UK has forced the St. Lucia Tourist Board to take pause and reevaluate its marketing strategy there. The UK is the island's second largest source market, but the decision to leave the EU and the resulting slide of the pound sterling has meant the price of everything, including vacations, has shot up. Don Nicholas explains.
The Tourist Board reported a 0.6% decline in stayover arrivals as of the end of July 2016. The Canadian market grew by 51%, whereas the Caribbean showed a 2% decline. However, of grave concern to tourism authorities was the 12% decrease in the UK market, which is St. Lucia's second largest. Officials noted that because of the devaluation of the pound, many British travelers have decided to remain at home and take advantage of staycation packages. To this end, the board has embarked on a special marketing initiative to take place in the UK next week. Several local hoteliers will be on hand to meet with various tour operators.
What we will be doing next week in the UK, as I did mention, is it's a very important market for us. And we have a special promotion where we'll be getting all the trade providers who sell St. Lucia to be engaged with our local hoteliers and ourselves as a destination promoting agency for a day and a half in really pushing and selling St. Lucia.
With less ships calling into port Castries, the cruise sector recorded a 16% decrease. The newly appointed tourist board's first order of business was to familiarize itself with the board's operations and financial position. Given what the board says is the limited $34 million budget, it has requested that the government adopt a new policy for the Jazz Festival. Officials say a large chunk of resources has been pumped into the festival. In an effort to cut back on expenditure, the new board has also decided to explore digital marketing.
Given a limited budget, the digital marketing gives us the ability to target specifically persons who would have an interest in coming to St. Lucia as a visitor. It gives us a little more focus and a little more bang for our money. So we're also looking at doing some things that the Tourist Board has not done before for the last few years with their limited budget. So we're looking at some television advertising, we're looking at some radio as well.
Tourism Minister Dominic Fede highlighted the importance of marketing.
Some of our destinations that are competing with us in the Caribbean are certainly ahead of us in terms of embracing the yachting sector as an economic driver. We see a lot of destinations, well, a few in the Caribbean, that would have boat builders and repairmen and engineers and electricians and so on. So the opportunity does exist for servicing those boats.
Mr. Fede made mention of the appointment of a special committee to improve the yachting sector. For the DBS News World, I am Don Nicholas.
The St. Lucia Electricity Services Limited, Lucilex, says it can now locate faults on its southern 66 kilovolt or KV transmission network faster and more precisely. That's because the company has invested in a traveling wave fault locator system that provides the location of faults on the 66 KV lines to within 50 meters. The new system would facilitate rapid response to correct faults, minimize cost, and improve reliability of the network. The traveling wave fault locator system uses Google Earth and Geographic Information System technology to definitively pinpoint faults to within adjacent 66 kV structures. Before the introduction of the traveling wave locator system, Lucilec maintenance crews would have to patrol the entire 66 kV line when investigating the cause of a fault. With the new system, what often took hours and a lot of guesswork will now be immediately pinpointed to a precise location. Lucilec system control engineer Gary Eugene says the latest improvements are designed to work with the redundancies built into the transmission network to ensure customers experience fewer and shorter power interruptions. Lucilec says it intends to install the system on the northern ring of the 66 KV transmission system, which includes the company's substations at Castries, Union, and Raidery. Time now for Everyday People with Alex Buske.
Meet Morella Mitchell, widely known as Virgie, a woman who has a passion for cooking and whose cooking people in turn seem to develop a passion for. She says she has been cooking for the past 40 years.
I used to sell cable and wireless. From cable and wireless, I used to go Bryden's. Then afterward, I start opening my little thing on my own.
But Virgie says during her 40-year career, it has not always been easy.
It's a lot of challenge. I used to do good before. I used to go by the road there, then the sand planting behind me. Then I come inside there. It's a lot of fight down, but I holding on. And I have backup. My customers following me wherever I go. Bryden's, cable and wireless, Wesco, electricity, taxi drivers. And I think people telling one another, and that's where they come.
She runs the Humbert Boispin food shop where she offers breakfast and lunch.
In the morning, I make salad, saltfish smoke herring. I make my little pizza. I make my own bread. I fry chicken. I make cocoa tea, Toloma sometimes. On Saturdays, I make cashew nut tea. I make cocoa tea. I make cowhill soup and different little Creole food.
The super cook says she caters for everyone. At least she tries to.
I have saltfish bouillon. I have breadfruit, green fig, dashin. I have sweet plantain. I have potato. I have stew pork. I have turkey. I have bucks. I have fish. And I have saltfish, roast saltfish. And hard dumpling, boiling big water.
Virgie says most people enjoy her food because it's home-style cooking.
I think, well, when they come here, they think, well, that's home. They eat home food. So some people come in there, I don't even know a name. But they know my name because when they come, they call Miss Virgie. Who's Miss Virgie? So I guess other people telling them and they come in and look for me.
She is proud of her customers who support her and who come from all walks of life.
When I sit down there, I just feel proud to see the kind of people that come in and make me sell. Like they say, it's not big. Big short is nothing, but the people that come in is very important to me, and I'm sure it's important to them also.
Morella Mitchell, better known as Miss Virgie, was born in the district of Choiseul and migrated to Castries from the age of 15. She now calls Virgie her home. She has only recently put up her business sign because she thinks a business with no sign is more like a sign of no business. For Everyday People, I am Alex Bousquet.
Thank you very much, Alex. When the DBS News World continues in just a moment, news of a planned royal visit, not well received in all quarters. Thanks so much for staying with the DBS News World. The island's minister with responsibility for education has commended students and parents of students of the George Shaw Secondary School for their patience and understanding while operations at the school were transferred to the John Odlum Secondary School. The move is to allow the transfer of three divisions of the Sir Arthur Lewis Community College to the George Shaw Secondary School while rehabilitation work is undertaken at the college.
Students of the George Charles Secondary School are being encouraged to embrace temporary changes instituted by the Department of Education for the new academic year. Those words were reiterated by the Minister for Education, the Honorable Dr. Gil Rigobert, as she addressed the students at an assembly on the first day of school. The students and teachers of George Charles have been temporarily relocated to the John Odlum Secondary to accommodate some divisions of the Sir Arthur Lewis Community College, presently undergoing extensive repairs.
Let me wish you a very successful academic year. Too very often, we have preconceived notions of what the journey ahead holds. I ask you to be open-minded. Put your muscle to the wheel. Open your minds to learning new things. Put all of your divinely ordained talents to work. Do not allow yourselves to be distracted by people who are concerned with creating mischief, but stay focused on your goals. Make your school, your community, your parents, your principal proud.
The minister also thanked parents for the immeasurable support demonstrated in the education of their children.
You, the parents, I am really encouraged by your numbers here. It tells me that you have a very keen interest not only in your children, but in the life of your school as well.
that you indeed are part and parcel of the family of George Charles Secondary School. Your presence here means a lot to me, and I'm sure it means a lot to the students that you are here to walk through this process with them, lending the necessary moral support.
Students of the George Charles Secondary are expected to undertake an orientation exercise ahead of the official start of classes. The Department of Education is providing transportation for teachers and students of George Charles to the John Odlam Secondary on a daily basis. From the Communications Unit of the Ministry of Education, Innovation, Gender Relations and Sustainable Development, I am Fennel Neptune reporting.
His Royal Highness Prince Harry of Wales will visit several Caribbean islands later this year. An official statement from Kensington Palace says he will visit Antigua and Barbuda, Barbados, Grenada, Guyana, St. Vincent and the Grenadines, St. Kitts and Nevis, and St. Lucia. The visit coincides with the 50th Independence Anniversary celebrations in both Barbados and Guyana and the 35th Anniversary of Independence for Antigua and Barbuda. But not everyone here is happy with the planned visit. Alex Boske has the details.
Prince Harry is scheduled to visit St. Lucia sometime this year. As customary, members of the royal family visit countries where England plays or has played a significant role in their history. But local Rastafarian and PRO of ICA, Aaron Alexander, thinks the royal visit is quite insignificant to St. Lucia. Unless there are benefits, he says, it is all superficial.
I mean, what is he really coming for? What is he bringing to us? What is he bringing to the table? I mean, are our leaders ready to confront this kind of people? Because today or tomorrow, you don't know, you know, he could become the king of England. You know, you could find all kind of situations could happen. So what are these people bringing to the table? We saw the former Prime Minister of England, David Cameron, he visited Jamaica. He offered them a prison. The Prime Minister at the time, Portia Miller Simpson, she choked. Like Donald Trump is doing now, went to bring up the issue of reparations with these leaders. I mean, is our own Alan Chastney, Prime Minister in St. Lucia, ready to ask him what are his views on these kind of issues?
Alexander is questioning the point of the visit. What is he offering and what are his views on the issues confronting the country?
What is his stance on this kind of issues, which is very dear to the people's heart, you know, especially Rastafari. This thing is dear to our heart and it should be dear to the heart of African descendants generally. We saw back when we got independence from England, Sir John choked. He never asked the Queen, okay, we get in independence, where is our reparations? You know, all the years of abuse and all the years of exploitation, where is the reparations? Where is, you know, what are we entitled to as far as these things are concerned? Sir John choked on us.
So, Mr. Alexander says he does not think that the Prince's visit will boost St. Lucia's image any more than what Darren Sammy, Laverne Spencer, Derek Walcott and Sir Arthur Lewis have already done. For the DBS News World, I am Alex Busque.
A call is going out for more assistance for Cyril Felix, better known in the Calypso circles as Get Through. Mr. Felix, the founder of the 34-year-old takeover tent, has been hospitalized following multiple health complications.
We are still appealing to the public to contribute whatever they may, whatever they can, to the account number 141115406 at the Bank of St. Lucia in my name, Truscott Augustine. And it would be gratefully appreciated if a contribution could be made towards Getro's medical fees.
Mr. Augustine would like to thank all those who have supported the cause so far. A musician, meanwhile, is lamenting the lack of local support for artists from the public as well as broadcast stations. He says the lack of support makes it nearly impossible to make a living doing music. Alex Boske has his story.
John Antoine is a local vocalist with big dreams. He says his music is different and appeals to everyone. He highlights one of his motivational songs entitled Just Cry, one he says he wrote just for the ladies.
It's a motivation song. And also, the song actually was written about 2 years ago. It's called Just Cry. And actually the song was written for female. And because oftentimes you have a lot of female groups, a lot of problems in their life. But then what I did, I just change the lyrics around and just make it just a general song for everybody. And also because of all the suicidal and all the depression people are going through, you know, so I just thought it's a song that will appeal to people that are going through certain situation in their life. You know.
The song entitled Just Cry was released on YouTube for feedback from both here and abroad.
I try to think outside the box, you know what I mean, because oftentimes we hear that radio personnel, you hear the DJ saying that, you know, St. Lucians need to think outside of the box lyrically, you know what I mean. So, you know, when I write my music, I try to appeal not just for St. Lucia, but for the international market. And you know, that's the direction I really want to go to, you know, to appeal to the international market. My ultimate goal is to make it to the big stage, you know what I mean? So if I have to do that, my music and my lyrics and whatever I do has to be on that kind of level. You know?
With all that said, he admits that he is not earning royalties from his music so far, and the fact that local disc jockeys aren't giving sufficient airplay to good local music is a further hindrance.
Not yet, because I registered with Echo only this year, and they told me hopefully next year. You know, but then the royalties will come when the radio station started playing our music, you understand? You know, I mean, you don't play it one day and then leave it until next, you know? So the radio station has to play the music, play our music, not just my music, but all our music. The music is good, and I mean, play it, you know what I mean? You know? You will hear Rihanna's song playing at least about 100 times for the day, understand? Claudia Edward, I mean, I remember I went online and checked out Claudia Edward. I mean, I was just amazed to see the talent that we have in St. Lucia, but I hardly hear Claudia Edward songs on the radio.
Despite all the motivational songs, he says up-and-coming artists like himself cannot depend solely on music to make ends meet in St. Lucia. And that, he says, is just sad. For the DBS News World, I am Alex Busquet.
Sports is next when the DBS News World continues with Brian Calixt.
Welcome to the DBS Sports. We started with news on cricket and more uncertainty in West Indies cricket. The future of West Indies coach Phil Simmons will be discussed at this weekend's West Indies Cricket Board meeting to be held in Dominica. Rumours have been circulating that a Trinidad and Tobago-born former West Indies all-rounder was fired by the WICB, but a top-ranking official associated with the regional organisation who spoke on condition that his identity remains anonymous said that was not the case. It is understood that there has been talk that Simmons will be replaced by another former West Indies player in Jimmy Adams. The Jamaican is currently coach of English side Kent in the English County Championship. The source added that Simmons' position will be discussed at the upcoming board meeting this weekend. In basketball, two more matches were played last Saturday in the KFC Commercial Basketball League. There were wins for St. Lucia Teachers Union and St. Lucia Fire Service. In game one of the evening, St. Lucia Teachers Union defeated the Renwick Cosmos 67-48, while in game two, the St. Lucia Fire Service, they doused Les Sports 75-48. Two-time Junior Footballer of the Year, Nyron Winter and Melvin Doxley, his under-17 and under-20 teammate, departed St. Lucia on Monday for the English Midlands, where they'll be training with a number of professional clubs for the next fortnight. The players will be hoping to make enough of an impression to open doors to possible professional careers. 17-year-old Winter and 18-year-old Doxley are expected to spend 5 days at Preston North End. They will then travel east to League One club Bradford City. Cyril Powell, the technical director of the St. Lucia Football Association, believes the move for Winter and Doxley could evolve into something significant for the young players. The trip was made possible by St. Lucia's Department of Youth Development and Sports with support from Leisure Travel. Silly news on football. The thrust for sustained development of local female talent in the sport and discipline of football continues to be one of the mandates of the St. Lucia Football Association. To this end, the association organized an under-21 football tournament. The semifinals of this tournament takes place this Saturday, September 10th at the Mabuya Playing Field. The matchups are in Game 1, VA4 North, they take on Sufre. That game kicks off at 2 p.m. While in Game 2, VA4 South, they take on the Mabuya Valley. And that game kicks off at 4 p.m. Don't go away. More sports still to come.
You're just in time for the usual reminder. The opposition takes the government to task for breaking an election promise to halve the driver's license fees. A Toronto-based hospital introduces local health practitioners to a faster, more accurate test for sickle cell disease. A call for a progress report on the John Compton Dam dredging project and an accounting for the funds collected to undertake it. And the minister with responsibility for tourism calls for urgent action on crime as concerns about its potential impact on the tourism sector grows. And that's the DBS News World. Thank you so much for watching and listening to the broadcast. On behalf of the entire news team, I'm Timothy Poole, wishing you a very good evening and inviting you to stay with us, because at 8:30, Rick Quinn will be in with the program Talk. Goodbye.